prices are stable because at the level at which they were increased in 2016, 2017, isn't it?
Yeah.
We've had this discussion too many times.
We've had this too many times. Yes. And this civil
unrest... So it's not because Nigerians are comfortable with the price of 2 barrels of yam at 900 naira for one.
No, they're not comfortable with it, but, you know, with Nigerians, they more or less accept what it is at the moment, hoping that, you know, in the nearest future, prices would actually, you know, come down. They only, at this point, most of them think, okay, what we see now is only a temporary situation, but it's going far longer than what they expect.
So that's consumer confidence.
That's consumer confidence.
The confidence that tomorrow things will be better, I'll come back to the market, the price of Gari Olodo or whatever it is will go down. Derica, rise.
Electricity as well. On Tuesday, we spoke about electricity not even, you know, surpassing the 4,000 megawatt level. But today, we've seen electricity increase to about 4,125 megawatt, which is...
I'm sure a lot of our viewers are not going to clap for you on that. What? Let's just move on. because folks want to see that in their homes. The beer parlor... Oh, sorry, that's not... She didn't talk about alcohol at this time of the day. At about what you called a leisure spot, yeah. What if you call it that way. Whatever you're drinking there, that's your business. I drink, I know what I drink, and that's my business. But we're all in the business of drinking something, whether it is tea or coffee, whatever it is. But let us move this further, because I know... If we, let's do the current market survey, and I put that put up for our viewers on the screen. Look, prices seem to be a little bit flat.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at when will I see some change in this? What will spur it?
Well, what we've seen that would directly affect the prices of some of these commodities, it's... the harvest period. So when we get right now, I think some of these products were in the planting season for some of them. So when we get closer to the summer period, we should see, you know, more of these commodities harvested, and that should increase the supply. So right now, is only the only things affecting the prices are, you know, either the supply or demand factors. Demand is a bit stable at the moment. Most people, it hasn't really changed. But when it comes to supply, the harvest season increases supply, which, you know, brings down the prices. And then it goes back to the cycle of, you know, once the harvest season is over, you get back to the planting season. And so those are the factors that we see affect, you know, commodity prices for now. Except there's a fundamental change within the system. Less focus on oil diversification, more, you know, investments in some of these farm areas, you know, more concentration on even the farmers themselves that are, you know, producing some of these goods. Like we talked about coffee on Tuesday, I didn't mention the fact that there's actually a Fair Trade Foundation which takes into consideration, you know, farmers, their well-being, are they able to get, you know, are they able to get enough, you know, income to produce some of these goods? So it's thinking about, you know, the beginning chain of the production of some of these commodities.
Yeah, so we need to, what do you expect the government to do?
Well, the government... increase in investments. If the government doesn't even have enough funds to invest, they should create a situation where the private sector also, you know, channels investments within
the sector. And when the private sector says they want a lower interest rate regime.
Well, with the interest rate regime, we're hoping that in the next MPC, you know, meeting, we see a situation where interest rates are actually tapered down, because even with the IMF, reiteration of the forecast for GDP 2.1%, it gives the CBN or the MPC committee more, you know, hope that economic growth would actually, you know, stay longer than what they expect. And in that case, and also with inflation as well, inflation is coming down. Those are the two factors they actually look at when they're comparing whether they should increase or leave interest rates.
Now the IMF is warning everyone that by the year 2020, when the millennium would have turned 20 years old, remember Y2K?
No.
I remember Y2K. Yeah, it was Y2K. I'm sure you will. Now you know what's called Y2K then. The year 2000.
What?
Well, you know all the fears around the year 2000, yeah. Whether phones will stop working, televisions will shut down and things and all that. By 2020, we'll be about 20 years old, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so, and now the IMF is warning that there are risks. So we're accumulating more debt because we're doing more borrowings, not from the World Bank, which is concessionary, but from the market, which is like Eurobond and all of that. So if you look at Nigeria, with our EIGP and whatever, we're in 2018. Mm-hmm. We have 2 years to that time. Yesterday's report from Washington says 3 years, technically, is going to be bumpy. You think, so how do you think we should spend this oil money? Almost 100%, about 80% above our
Well,
the budget benchmark.
The IMF, you know, welcomed the fact that obviously we've made progress so far. You know, they did state that in their report. But at the same time, what they look at is the fact that, is this debt sustainable? Are you bracing for future shocks? You know, now we're happy that all prices have recovered, especially commodity-dependent countries like ours. We've mentioned severally that, you know, with this oil shock, we should brace ourselves for future shocks that could occur. And IMF, with the financial recession in 2009, they have no other option but to warn, you know, economy.
It's almost 10 years after.
Exactly.
That is 2018. It's almost 10 years after. It looks like we're coming almost full circle.
And most countries don't, it's like they almost forget the past where they came from. It's
humans,
like,
we always do.
We always do. So it's kind of like them warning that, you know, this
What was the problem with us humans, really?
Well,
I'm a human and you are. I don't know. Whether we should ask the robots what the problem is with humans, because sometimes we just forget that we've been through this before.
We do, but
and we should prepare.
We should be thankful that we have an organization that actually reminds us of how we should, you know, we should plan ahead. And also, I think IMF is also talking about this in hopes that, you know, we think about the fact that, okay, we're in the political season. Mm-hmm. And most times when it comes to debt, politically, debt is favorable. You know, if you're trying to win, you know, voters, if you're trying to win votes, you try to, you know, spend more, you know, tax less and all that. So at this point, if we have our economy growing to sustainable levels, we should brace for those, you know, shocks that could occur in
when,
the future.
When prices of commodities go down.
Yeah, exactly. So in actual fact, they're saying we should increase taxes, but not at this point, but in the nearest future, we should start thinking about that in order to pay back our debt.
Well, you're looking for some trouble with that. But fasten your seatbelt.
Yeah.
Bolanle Richardson, thank you very much.
Thank
Let's
you.
All fasten our seatbelt for the bumpy ride by the year 2020. From Financial Derivatives Company, Bolanle Richardson, a member of the economic team. You've heard that warning from the IMF. Let's come back after the break. The numbers from the banks and others are coming in for the first quarter. Let's chew that together when we return, shall we?